Welcome to this afternoon session. We'll have speakers today from Italy, Chile and Portugal, who are united by their interest in the field of elliptic and parabolic PDEs, and more specifically that large and beautiful area, which is the maximum principle and its applications. So the first one will be Isabel Birindelli from La Sapienza Università di Roma. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you. First, of course, I would like to thank the organizing, the committee, to invite me here. I must say, this must be the most beautiful room I have given a talk in, so I'm very glad. Also technologically impressive, so. So even though it's technologically impressive, I was even more impressed by the green board, so I'm going to give the talk on the board. And even though my writing is not very good, but I hope that it's going to work with this. So let me start by saying that this is a joint work with Fabiana Leoni and Filomena Pacella. The three of us are in the University of Rome, La Sapienza, but this work was started in the end of the world at Punta Arenas at a conference. So that's where we started working together, even though we shared the same department for some years now. So so let me start. So where I'm looking at some problem. So we are in a bounded domain. I have a fully nonlinear equation. And so this is, and u is 0 on the boundary of omega. And the question, the goal, is when can we expect the solution u to inherit the symmetry of the operator capital F and of the domain omega. Of course, this is a vast question, and like this, the answer is never no. But let me start by a very simple example. So I'm sorry everybody knows about this, but it's going to be helpful to understand the philosophy of what I'll talk about. So I'm going to consider a very simple case when omega is a ball, say the ball of center R, 0 and radius R, and I look at the Laplace operator, and in fact I could look at the eigenvalue of the Laplacian, so with Dirichlet boundary condition. Sorry, this is the ball. So of course everybody knows that we have a sequence of numbers called eigenvalue, etc. And for which one of these we have an eigenfunction. And I'm going to concentrate on the first two. So the first eigenfunction, phi 1, it's well known that it is, in fact, radial. Let me write it. In fact, it is it is a Bessel function, just to connect with yesterday's talk. And so it is radial. So in fact, indeed, it keeps all the symmetry that you want, in the sense that the Laplacian is invariant with respect to reflection, to rotation. The domain is invariant with respect to any reflection. So this is what you have. Instead, if we look at the function corresponding to the second eigenvalue, so let's say the second eigenfunction, then this is up to a rotation. You can write it as, say, x1 times some other Bessel function, some other radial Bessel function. So at this point already, we see that the answer to this question is, in general, no, in the sense that phi2 has some symmetry, but it doesn't have all the symmetry because, of course, this function is not symmetric with respect to the plane, say, x1 equals 0. So here it's negative, here it's positive. Instead, it is symmetric with respect to the hyperplane orthogonal to this plane, OK? So this is the situation. So it's clear that one needs some property. Another remark that I need to do is that phi is the only eigenfunction that doesn't change sign inside the domain, OK? So it's a positive eigenfunction. So things are very different if one is looking at positive solution or if one is looking at sign-changing solution. Okay, so let's say that in this talk I will be more interested in a certain sense at looking at things that look like the second eigenfunction more than the first eigenfunction. So we're not considering positive solution, but in general, so there are no conditions on the sign here. All right, so now let me spend some time in explaining what kind of operator I have in mind. So the condition that is going to be always true is that f is uniformly elliptic. So by uniform ellipticity, this is standard, but let me remind everybody what we mean is that if we take a difference between f computed in some matrix m plus n, and we look at it at the matrix M, then we can bound it above by some, so the trace on N of N times beta greater than alpha times the trace of N, where alpha is some positive number and beta is greater or equal than alpha. And this must be true for any positive, semi-positive definite matrix N. Okay, so this is uniform ellipticity. Clearly, the first example one can consider is just a linear operator. If you take trace of a times the Hessian, then of course it's immediate to see that if A is a matrix between alpha I and beta I, then this condition is satisfied. Okay, so this is just a generalization of this kind of operator, if you want. And sometime I will not write explicitly the dependence on X. Okay, so we may sometimes write on there. So this is what we always assumed. And let me mention that, in fact, another way of of writing the same condition, if one doesn't want to restrict to positive definite matrices, then this same condition can be written in the following way. Instead of looking only at positive definite matrices, it's immediate to see that if you write this as n plus minus n minus, then here what you will get is beta times the positive part of n minus alpha times, no, I think I should not get out of this line. And this is greater than alpha times the trace of n plus minus beta times the trace of n minus, okay? So this is, n is written as n plus minus n minus. So what is the thing that appears here? This should be true for any n, okay? Matrix, of course, symmetric matrices. So these are called the Pucci operators. So we will call M plus of alpha beta this operator here. So this is the matrix N is just alpha times the sum of the positive eigenvalues. Sorry, beta times the positive eigenvalues plus alpha times the sum of the negative eigenvalues. And M minus, so this is a Pucci operator. And M minus is the operator that appears here. Okay. So this is alpha times the trace of the positive minus beta. OK. So why are these are very important operators. Most people here know this, but let me remind you that these are called extremal operator, Pucci's extremal operator, because in fact, if you take any linear operator that is bound, for which the matrix is bounded above and below by the same constant alpha and beta that we have seen before, then M plus is just the soup of all possible linear operator, while taking this between alpha I and beta I. And this is just the inf between alpha I. So what we are saying is that any uniformly elliptic operator is bounded above and below by this extremal operator. So these operators are going to play a very important role in this theory, but in general for fully nonlinear operator. So, and they're going to be an example for what we want to see. So what we see here is that these operators depend only on the eigenvalue of the Hessian. So if you have a property that for which the eigenvalue of the Hessian is invariant, you would have it for the Pucci operators. And so we are talking about symmetry and invariance. So let's see what we mean by that. So the operator we are interested in should be, on one hand, uniformly elliptic, so bounded above and below by the Pucci operators. And on the other end, we want them to be invariant with respect to symmetry and orthogonal. So let me fix some notation here. So suppose that we have E is a unit vector. And we call H of E the plane, the hyperplane that is orthogonal to E. And in general, we will call omega E the intersection of omega with the half space x dot e greater than 0. So when we divide the domain in this way, and omega minus e, and so this will be true for any vector e. And then we will denote by sigma e of x the reflection with respect to the upper plane. So just x minus twice. OK, so this is just the reflection with respect to the hyperplane HE. So if you're here, you reflect on the other side. OK, so to be invariant means that if V of X is just U computed on the other side of the hyperplane, then what we obtain, F is invariant, is F of V is just equal to F applied to the Hessian of U and then computed in sigma E of X. OK, so it's invariant in this sense. And of course, this gives is a precise condition. And it's easy to see that for the Pucci operator satisfies this invariance for any direction E, OK, because this is true for the eigenvalue of the Hessian. And the same thing for M minus. Of course, invariant by rotation instead means that if V of X is U OX for some orthogonal matrix X, O, then what we want is that F of DT, same thing. Okay? So I'm not going to write the detail, but this is what we mean. Okay, so we have invariance in this sense. Now I can be so a little more precise in the question. So the question is, suppose that F is invariant with respect, capital F, is invariant with respect to the reflection of one hyperplane, and omega is symmetric with respect to the same hyperplane, we would like to know under which condition U is going to be symmetric with respect to this hyperplane, because this is precisely the question in this setting. Now, so the answer is, so if U is, so the master tool in this game, when U is positive, then what is being used now for many decades is the moving plane method. The moving plane method, I'm not going to enter into the detail, but needs the solution to be positive and domain omega to be convex. OK? It's well known this goes back to Alexandrov. Then, of course, there is an important paper by Serrin on overdetermined problem. And of course, there is the paper by Gidas, Nie, and Nierenberg. Okay, but there's been a plethora of results in this direction, which I'm not going to mention. I just would like to mention that in the fully nonlinear case, so the case in which we're interested today, the symmetry result for positive solution have been obtained already by Gidas, Nie, and Nierenberg. This was for classical solution, C2, say. Then there is a paper by Dalio and Sirakov that gives the same result, but for viscosity solution. And then more recently, there's some result on overdetermined problem. One is by myself and de Mangel, and there is another paper by Sylvestre and Sirakov. I think that's all that is, I mean, this is the only paper I know about symmetry of fully nonlinear equation in this symmetry for fully solution of fully nonlinear equation. So this is not what we want to look at. So the question we want, I repeat, is that we wonder if some sort of symmetry like the second eigenfunction still holds for this operator. So let me go back one moment to what is known in the semilinear case. So when the operator here is the Laplacian, but the solution U is not positive. So I'm going to erase the uniform ellipticity condition, which should be here. Okay. And so let me talk about the semilinear case. Okay, so what I mean by semilinear is that here we have, say, an equation of this kind. And so we're supposing now that omega is symmetric with respect to some plane, say, x1 equals 0. Okay, and we would like to know if U is actually symmetric with respect to the same plane. So the idea is to look at a function U, that is a function W, which is just the difference between U at the point X and U at the reflected point. So U X minus U, so here this would be just minus X1 X prime. So let's do U X1 X prime. Okay, so we have this difference, and the Laplacian is invariant, so the Laplacian of W is the difference of the Laplacians. So what we obtain, suppose for a moment that F is convex. Okay, so I'm adding a condition here. And then it's easy to see that W satisfies Laplace of W plus the derivative of S with respect to U in XU times W equal to 0. This is greater or equal. So W is a subsolution of this equation. And at the same time, of course, W is 0. Now, where is W 0? W is 0, of course, on the boundary of omega. But more interesting, it's 0 on this half on the plane X1 equals 0 because of its definition, really. So in fact, what we have is that this inequality is true when I put myself in omega here. This is E1, okay? And on the boundary of omega of E1. So I can look at half a domain. I look at this half here. And in this part, I know that W is a solution of this equation, is a subsolution of this equation. And of course, it's the same true is on the other side. Okay, so if I had some tool that gives me the sign of W, then I would be done. And this is exactly the maximum principle. So what I want to say is that if the maximum principle holds in this domain and in this domain, then I would have, so maximum principle would imply that W is negative in omega E1, but also in omega minus E1. So it would be negative here and negative here. So this gives that W is identically zero, because one is the opposite of the other. And so this would tell me that, so this would imply that U is symmetric. Okay. So how do I get the maximum principle? Well, the maximum principle is strictly related to the first eigenvalue, and precisely it is equivalent. So what we really have is the following fact. So what we have proved in a certain sense is that if lambda 1, let me call, see what is here, we have an operator, a domain. If this is positive, and also the first eigenvalue of the other domain is positive, so I have this. This implies the maximum principle hold. And F is convex. We need this, of course. This implies that U is symmetric. Okay, so this gives, so the sign of the eigenvalue in the half domain tells me something about symmetry. This is not exactly precise. So what I need is either these are strict and this is convex, or these are not strict and F has to be strictly convex. So these are the conditions, one or the other, but you need one of the two has to be strict. So, okay, so this is very much in the flavor of what we want to do. I mean, this is exactly the kind of result we want to obtain. So an information on the eigenvalues gives us an information on the symmetry of the solution. So this can be exactly repeated in the case of the fully nonlinear operator, because suppose so that now we are back to this problem, and we suppose that F is, so it's uniformly elliptic, it is invariant to respect to some reflection, say this one, omega is invariant with respect, is symmetric with respect to the same hyperplane. So if you do the same computation, the difference is that here you get F of, we're going to look at the difference of F of d2u computed in x minus F computed in minus x1 x prime. And this difference is not equal to the operator, because this is a full, it's not a linear operator. But instead, the uniform ellipticity condition that I have erased gives me that this is bounded above and below exactly by the extremal operator that we have defined at the beginning. So this is bounded above by m plus of the difference of these functions, and it's bounded by below by m minus of the difference. Okay? So this tells me that this is quality I cannot use if F is convex. But if F is convex, I can use this inequality. And so what we get by the convexity of F is that M plus of d2u, the d2w, plus df du w is actually a sub, so w is a subsolution of this equation on the boundary. So this is an omega e, and this is on the boundary of omega e. Okay, this is, I'm slightly cheating here because we're talking about viscosity solutions. So, of course, you're not looking at C2, so you need, there is a little work to be done, but this work was done already by Dalia and Sirakov, so we didn't have to do it. So we could, this is actually true. I mean, this inequality actually works even if the solution is not C2, but only viscosity solution. Okay, so of course, as you can imagine, everything works the same as long as you can define some condition that gives you the maximum principle. And this is what is now been done for a while, and it's well known. There is a theory of eigenvalue for this fully nonlinear operator. So let me just recall what it's about. So one can, so even though this operator is not linear, we can define a so-called principal eigenvalue. So this will play the role of this eigenvalue here in the sense that it corresponds to an eigenfunction that doesn't change sign. And the way to define it, of course, you cannot use Rayleigh quotient or the kind of, not this kind of characterization, but we can use the characterization given by Beresticky, Nierenberg, and Varadhan. So this has been extended to fully nonlinear equation by many people, Buscat, Esteban Quas, Quas Sirakov, Ishii, Yoshimura, myself, and de Mangel, many people. So so we're going to define lambda 1 plus as the sup of the value lambda such that there exists a function phi positive that is a subsolution, which is a super solution, sorry, I'm always getting out of the picture. No, it's okay. In omega. F here is some uniformly elliptic operator, and then this lambda 1 plus, and you can define similarly lambda 1 minus. But lambda 1 minus is, I take negative negative subsolution. Okay. Well, what is nice is that these two values have all the property we want, in the sense that you can associate a positive eigenfunction to lambda 1 plus and the negative eigenfunction for lambda 1 minus. They may not, lambda 1 plus and lambda 1 minus in general are not going to coincide. Instead, alpha is equal to beta. And you have the property that we want. So let me recall a few of these. So for example, if you have two domains, one inside the other, then you have that both eigenvalues are monotone with respect to inclusion. If you have a sequence of domain, one inside the other, the sequence converges to the union. So lambda plus or minus of dk, if I take the limit, this converges to of the union. And finally, which is maybe the most important property in this case, at least, is that if lambda 1 plus in a domain is positive, then the maximum principle holds. So this implies the maximum principle holds. What is the maximum principle? So we are saying this is really a positivity principle, in fact. It says that if you have a solution of, you have a subsolution which is negative on the boundary, then it's going to be negative inside. So this is in omega. This is on the boundary of omega. Then this would imply that V is negative in omega. Okay, so this is the maximum principle. So lambda 1 plus just gives the maximum principle. So the positivity of lambda 1 plus gives me the maximum principle. The positivity instead of lambda 1 minus implies the minimum principle. So you don't have both, like, of course, for the Laplacian. So in this case, on the contrary, you have that if you have a super solution, that is positive on the boundary, this gives you that V is positive inside. Okay. So you can see that all the ingredients are here, and so the result that was written here for the Laplacian just holds very well for a fully nonlinear operator, as long as you can define this. The interesting part is that you're not interested in the eigenvalue of the operator F for which you started, but you are interested in the sign of the eigenvalue for the so-called linearized operator, where instead of your operator capital F, you put the Pucci extremal operator. Okay? So, in fact, what we call a linearized operator, in fact, is not linear at all because it is fully nonlinear, but this is really what is going to play the role of the linearized operator. So, this is what is important will be the sign of the eigenvalue of this operator here in half domain, for example. Okay, so. So this is the very first result. But let me, of course, we would like to have more than that. Okay. Okay. So maybe I'll come back to that. So in fact, this is not enough. This doesn't really take all the feature of the second eigenfunction. So we want more than that. And in fact, what we want to consider is what is called foliated Schwarz symmetry. But I think it's not a very, I don't think it's a very nice name. I think of it as actual symmetry, seems much better to me. But so let's use the official name, foliated Schwarz symmetry. So, okay, Schwarz symmetry just means that something is radial and decreasing with respect to the radius, okay? Foliated Schwarz symmetry instead means the following thing. So function U is foliated Schwarz symmetric. Let me at least shorten it. If the following holds, so you want U if U depends only on the modulus of x, so the radius, okay, and the product of x with some value p. So let's say the arc cosine of x p over modulus of x. So there exists some vector p of norm 1. So with respect to this axis p, you have that u depends only on the radius r and the angle with respect to this this axis p. And we want something else, which justifies the name foliate, I guess, is that theta is u is monotone is theta. So what we are saying here is that you have an axis p. We are on a ball of radius r, you have fixed the radius r, and then the function is constant along this circle here, and then you will have other like this, and this is the cone instead where this would be your angle theta, okay? And this is the axis p. And you want the function u to be monotone with respect to these circles once you have fixed the radius r. And so this is exactly the symmetry you would get for the second eigenfunction, okay? Because the second eigenfunction, but it's going to be, so the, it's going to be, the axis p is going to be this one, if you take the one I had drawn before. So this would be the one x1 j modulus of x. So this is going to have, the circle are going to grow between minus 1 and I mean, the maximum and the infimum. So this is exactly the symmetry that you would like to prove. So under which condition can we expect to have this kind of symmetry. Okay, so let me write. Before writing the theorem, I would like to give some conditions that are equivalent somehow. If you have more regularities, this is a definition that doesn't require any regularity on the function u, but we have the following fact that maybe help understand what really one needs to prove in order to prove Poulietter Schwarz symmetry. This would be difficult like this. So if u is a continuous function, then it's quite easy, say in the ball B or in the anorus B, u is going to be is Poulietter Schwarz symmetric if and only if you have that for any direction E, u of sigma E of x is greater than u of x in BE, or the other way around. So you have one side that has to dominate with respect to the other. So you take any plane, any direction, and you look at u in this side, you compare it with u on this other side, and one of the two is going to be always bigger than the other one. So you look here and here, you will have always the same direction. So either you have that, or you have sigma e of x is smaller than u of x, always in the whole half domain, half ball, half anorus. Okay, so in particular, one sign, you're going to get one sign when e scalar, the famous xp, is positive, will give you one sign. And when e scalar p is negative, you get the other one. Okay? So this in particular tells you that if E is orthogonal to P, of course, then U has to be symmetric with respect to that direction. Okay? So this condition, be careful that if U is not continuous, there are counterexamples. But if U is continuous, you can characterize it this way. But even more, what we're actually going to use is another characterization. There you need U to be C1. So if u is C1b and continuous up to the boundary, then another characterization is that there exists one direction such that u is symmetric with respect to this direction. So you just choose one direction, and with respect to this direction, you ask u to be symmetric. Plus, you have to ask that if you take any vector E prime, which is different from E, and then you consider the plane generated by E and E prime, and you consider a polar angle coordinate in that plane, U theta E E prime, then the request is that the derivative of U with respect to this angle has to be monotone, so it has to be either positive or negative. Okay, so you need to have a monotonicity in the angle. So you have the vector E with respect to which you know you have symmetry. You fix another E prime. This gives you a plane, a hyperplane. You fix an angle theta in this hyperplane. And along this, when you move along this angle, your function has to be monotone with respect to theta. So the derivative of u with respect to the angle has to be either positive or negative, of course, depending on. You cannot control the sign, of course. Okay. So this is much less obvious that it gives the Poulietter-Schwarz symmetry. Nonetheless, can be proved. Of course, this would be asked for theta between 0 and pi. Okay. This is half, yes, it's for half, it's going to be in B, in B, I don't know how to say, because it may not be B, whatever, whenever you fix, when you fix the x, so if you fix this theta here, for example, then it's going to be in this half plate. So this is for theta in 0 pi, okay, it's just half a, of course. Okay, thanks. Okay, so this tells you somehow that what you care to prove is that you have one symmetry and one monotonicity. Okay, this is going to be very important. So the main result, so let me state the main result. So here we are supposing that F is, so capital F, the operator, is invariant. So think of the Pucci operator. But anyway, F is invariant with respect to any reflection sigma e, so for any direction. We suppose that omega, in fact, is a ball or an annulus. So radial bounded domain. And if we have the dependence of little f on x, of course, then you want f to be radial. So we put ourselves in the condition that f of x u is. Okay. So. Write this very well. So if there exists, so if there exists a direction E such that the eigenvalue, the principal eigenvalue that correspond to the positive eigenfunction of this linearized operator, where is it? I'm going to write down. So this is in the half ball. Just one half ball. If in one ball this is positive, then u is foliated Schwarz symmetric. Okay. Furthermore, if instead lambda, if we have, this is a stronger request, so if the lambda 1 of the same linearized, so-called linearized operator, it's u, of course, it's u, sorry, in the whole domain, in the whole ball is positive, so this is in the stable situation, then u is radial. So not surprisingly, I mean, the fact that you need the information only in one direction clearly comes the fact that in this characterization of foliated Schwarz symmetry, what you need is really to have a symmetry condition on one plane with respect to one hyperplane, and then monotonicity. Okay? Okay. So. This is the time. So before going ahead, maybe giving an idea of the proof, I would like to mention a few things. So first I didn't mention that in the semilinear case, this result and the previous result were due to Pascella and Wet. Maybe I should answer also some work with Gladiali. Also, there is something very surprising here. Somehow we are claiming that U has symmetry that is related to the symmetry of the second eigenfunction of the Laplacian. Now, I would like to emphasize that for fully nonlinear operator, practically nothing is known concerning the spectral of this operator beside the first eigenvalue. So the first eigenvalue is well known. We have all the properties that I mentioned and so on. Besides that, practically nothing is known. What is known is that in the radial case, because in the radial case is reduced to an ODE, and so then you can explicitly construct the sequence of radial eigenfunction and eigenvalue in the ball. But beside that, nothing is known. It's not even clear if there is a second eigenvalue exists and how it could be characterized and so on. On the other hand, usually this kind of results are given in terms of Morse index. So the typical result that you will find is in this line of research is, say, suppose the Morse index of some equation, of solution of some equation, is less than n, then U is a foliated Schwarz symmetric. The Morse index of a solution is the number of negative eigenvalue of the linearized operator. So here we cannot count the number of negative eigenvalues since we don't even know if there are the eigenvalue and what it would mean to be an eigenvalue. So the closest thing that goes to with this idea is the following definition. So when we can define mu2, let's define this number. We take the maximum between lambda 1 plus of some domain D and lambda 1 plus of omega minus D. Omega might be the ball if we are in the case of the ball, or omega is just the whole domain. And D is a subdomain of omega. And then we consider the inf between all the subdomain. Okay? This number is easy to see. It's not an eigenvalue for the Pucci operator. This is very simple to see. If alpha equal to beta, so when the Pucci operator reduces to the Laplacian, this is the second eigenfunction. Okay? And of course, if you see this theorem, the condition, a corollary, an immediate corollary, is that if mu2 is positive, because mu2, here I'm referring to the eigenvalue of the linearized operator, of course. So if mu2 is positive, then U is foliated Schwarz symmetric. Because, of course, if mu2 is positive and you have one direction in which the lambda 1 is positive, you are done. If in one direction it's negative, well, this means that the other one, the opposite direction is going to be positive. And so you have found another direction in which the lambda 1 is positive. And so you have that U is foliated Schwarz symmetric. So the request is this one. Okay? So somehow this would recall the idea of the second eigenvalue. So I would like to say a few properties that are in fact consequences of this result concerning the spectral of the Pucci operator. So it's clear that this condition is not a very nice condition because it's very difficult to judge. I mean, it's going to be easier to see if a solution is foliated Schwarz symmetric than to compute the sign of the first eigenvalue of this operator. So this seems a strange condition. It's nearly more interesting in the other direction. That is, suppose you have a solution that is not foliated Schwarz symmetric. This is going to tell you an information about the sign of the eigenvalue of this operator. Okay? So it's more like in this direction that it can be, let's say, useful than in this one. So this is a characterization, but very difficult to consider. Okay? So let me tell you about consequences of this fact for the spectral properties of the Pucci operator. Now, this is a terrible dilemma. If I don't keep the glasses, I don't see. But if I keep the glasses, you see the glasses there. So very embarrassing. So I will do something. Okay. So, now, beside the joke. So let me tell you a few things that are interesting. So one is the following. Suppose that you take, there is, in a paper of Scott Armstrong a few years ago, he defined the following quantity. So he defined the second eigenvalue, okay, even though nobody knows what it is, in the following way. So he takes the inf of the value lambda greater than the greatest of the two eigenvalues, of the first eigenvalues, such that lambda is an eigenvalue for m plus. Okay, now I forget about, I just concentrate on the spectral property of m plus. So my operator now is just m plus. Okay. Okay, we don't know if this set is empty. So if it is empty, this is going to be infinity. If it is not empty, he proved that anyway, lambda 2, lambda, capital lambda 2, is strictly greater than lambda 1 minus. And what is interesting is that if you take any lambda between lambda 1 minus and capital lambda 2, then he proved that one could actually solve the problem, so the Dirichlet problem could be solved, because there exists a solution of the Dirichlet problem for a continuous function f. Okay, so this lambda here now is in between these two values. It could be between this and plus infinity. Lambda 2 is plus infinity. But this tells you that I can solve the problem even though I'm not below the principal eigenvalue, which is usually what is requested. So somehow it's important to have an evaluation of this value here because it tells you how much you can go further. And so one thing that we can prove here is, thanks to the result we have obtained, the main result here, is the following. That if we take, so proposition, so if we call lambda 1 half, just to make to be simpler for a moment. So lambda 1 half is just going to be lambda 1 plus in the half ball. Okay, so we are here, we are concentrating on the case of the ball. Okay, and we are looking at the first eigenvalue of the Pucci operator in the half ball. So it doesn't depend on the direction E, of course, because it's invariant with respect to rotation. So we're really considering half the eigenvalue in half the Laplace. So what we can prove is that lambda, capital lambda 2, is greater than lambda plus 1 half. So this already gives a bound on capital 2. But we can also prove that if I look at the second radial eigenvalue, okay, so suppose that we look at only the radial eigenfunction, I consider the second eigenvalue that corresponds to the second radial eigenfunction, so I'm not considering the other one. This one is strictly greater than lambda 1 half. And this is going to be just a direct application of this result here. So what we are saying is that somehow you, this, so these are, you know, this allows me to, tells me that I don't know if I can go up to capital lambda 2 because I don't know how much it is, but I know how to compute this, and then I know that we can solve this problem up to lambda 1 half plus, okay? So this is already interesting. Now, lambda 1 half plus, in the case of the Laplacian, maybe it's, I can see it here, is just the... is equal to the second eigenvalue of the Laplacian in the ball, okay? Because if you think of the second eigenfunction, it's going to be positive in a half ball, zero on the boundary, so lambda half is just the second eigenvalue of the Laplacian. So the question is, can we expect lambda 1 half plus to be the second eigenvalue of the Pucci operator in the half ball? Sorry, in the ball, of course. So this eigenvalue, which is in fact the eigenvalue of the half ball, for the Laplacian, it is in fact a second eigenvalue. Can we expect to be the second eigenvalue also for the Pucci operator? Well, I don't know. I don't have an answer to this question. But I can tell you the property that the eigenfunction would have if lambda 1 half plus was the second eigenvalue. Okay? So suppose that there exists a function for which this, that is a solution to the eigenvalue problem, and that has, for which has eigenvalue lambda 1 half. Let me say that in the second eigenvalue for the Laplacian, here you would have the second eigenfunction, as we have seen before, is so this is going to be the second eigenfunction for the Laplacian in the ball, but it's also the first eigenfunction for the Laplacian in the half ball. Okay. So in the case of the Pucci operator, we cannot expect this to be true, because if it was like that, you would have that the lambda plus in this half domain should be equal to the lambda minus in this other domain. And this is not possible, because lambda minus in general is strictly, for the Pucci plus Pucci operator, is strictly greater than lambda plus. So this is not possible. So we expect if there is an eigenfunction, it cannot be the one that you would construct in this way. It has to have some other property. So let me tell you the property that this eigenfunction has. So suppose now for a moment, so if lambda 1 half is an eigenvalue for m plus in the ball, then we have the following properties. So the first thing, of course, is that the eigen, so and psi 2 is the eigenfunction. Okay. So psi 2 cannot be radial, of course. This is just what we said here. The second property, and this is the result of the main result here, is that psi 2 is foliated Schwarz symmetry. So it has this radial symmetry and monotonicity with respect to some angle theta. Another consequence of the symmetry that we can prove here is that if you look at the nodal set of the second eigenfunction, of this second eigenfunction, the nodal set is just the closure of the set where psi 2 is equal to 0, so the closure of the x in the ball such that psi 2 is 0. Okay? So this nodal set will have to intersect the boundary of the ball. So we cannot expect to have a zero that turns around. The zero will have to go to the boundary, okay? And finally, the function psi 2, so the set where psi 2 is positive, same thing, cannot be contained in a half ball for any direction E. So it has to somehow be more, it has to invade. So if you have your, here you have your ball, then the nodal set will have to do something like this. I mean, that has a part that goes, has, is both in both half sets. Okay, so this is going to be, say, where it's positive, then you want something like that. Okay, whether this tells us that it's possible that lambda 1 half is an eigenvalue is not clear, but at least if it is, we have a few properties. Or if we can find that there is some function that it cannot be like that, then you would know that it's not an eigenvalue. So this is the okay. Well, I had a couple of other things, but I'm going to stop here. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. Any questions?